And take the church out of need. Amen. Well, good morning, church. I'm glad to see each and every one of you this morning. We had a very, very good teaching this morning on the armor of God, the pieces of it. Robin, I believe this is the time we need to know about this. Yes, you've heard it many, many times before. Ephesians 6:10. We need to go over it so we know what we have. Pastor's been telling us, if you don't know what this word says, then how can you fight against the enemy?
Amen.
You got it's spiritual warfare. We got spiritual warfare equipment to use. He's teaching on how to use it. Not just what it is, but how to use it. So I'd like to welcome everyone to New Life Fellowship service this morning. I am so glad to see everyone. Do we have any first-time visitors? Second time. First, oh, thank you, Don. He's our second. Praise the Lord. I'd like to remind you this morning, we'd like to get some donations. Just bring a can or two. You don't have to go through a great expense, but a can or two every Sunday or so. As you can, as the Lord leads you, so we put those in our food pantry, something that's got a good expiration date, so on and so forth. So, if you want to know about what types of food, there's a list on the bulletin board in the foyer there, right next to the water fountain. We had a very good attendance to our Friday night class, our disciples class. That starts at 6:30 every Friday night, goes to about 8 o'clock. Come be part of that. We just got into chapter 1 of our little book, so. Come, so we can look into that. So, again, that's our class for Friday night, starts at 6:30. Discipleship is what it's about. Amen. And also, we will have services tonight. Bring your books. Josh is going to do his teaching tonight. That starts at 6:30 as well. So, anyway, I am so thankful that our yard guy came yesterday and mowed the front, so it was extremely, extremely well out front. So, anyway, yes, let's just praise God about that. That young man, I think he worked his way through college, and he does an excellent job. So, let's just keep him in prayer that he can continue to do what he's doing. Amen. I believe he is a Christian. Is that right, Pastor? He is a Christian, young Christian man. Anyway, let's go to our Abba Father. Abba Father, once again, we just want to thank you for this day. I thank you so much, Father, that we have a place to come to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, as we go through this morning service and all through the day, help us to have our hearts on you. Help us to have our minds renewed, so that we may hear from you this day through our beloved pastor as he brings the word for us this day. Help us to know and understand what you need for us to know this day, Father. I thank you, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, for your presence among us this morning. Your word says that you will never leave us nor forsake us. And that's because you love us so much that we have your presence. And we know that you're always there because you have a listening ear. And all we have to do is just whisper your name, Jesus, and you hear us. And Father, as we go through this morning, I do thank you for the hedge of protection that you have placed round about us through the night, through this morning, through the travel from our homes to here. And through this service, that you're going to watch over us and keep us safe, Father God, that we we hear what your word has to say. Father, once again, we just want to thank you so much for this privilege that we have to come to worship you in spirit and in truth. And as we go through this day, Father God, we know that you love us because you woke us up this morning to bring us here. And we ask all of this in the mighty name of Jesus, whom we love, and we declare it by saying, Amen. All right. Thank you. Praise the worship team. Let's go.
Hallelujah. Praise be to you. Hallelujah. We're going to trust in you this morning, Father God. We're going to give all the praise, honor, and glory you deserve. We're going to give you a joyful noise. Hallelujah. Praise be to you. Yes, Father. Hallelujah.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountain, I need you to move. When you don't part the waters, I'll be sure to walk through. When you don't give the answers, and I cry out to you, I will trust in you. Yeah. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's one day ahead you have not seen. Someone thinking of life and bread. I wonder if you want more than nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, and I cry out to you, I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Yes.
You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the ground on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your ways are always good. And I'll be where I go. You know where you should. When you don't go the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. And you don't give the answers, and I cry out to you. I will trust in 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 you.
Yes, hallelujah. Praise be to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for loving us. No matter what we say about ourselves or what the world says about us, Father God, you say something different. Hallelujah. It's about what you say, Father God, and nothing else. Hallelujah. That is true.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Just the sum of every high and every once again just who I am because I need to know. Ooh, oh, you say I love when I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I am weak. And you say I am hell when I am falling short. And when I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe what you say for me. I believe the only thing that matters now is everything you think of me. You, I find my worth in you, I find my identity. Ooh, oh, you say I am loved when I can't feel the thing. You say I am strong when I think I am weak. And you say I am held when I am falling short.
Come as you are.
and be free. Oh, be free. No matter what you've done, you can't erase His love. Nothing can change it. Not separate it, no matter where you run. He's always holding on. You're still a daughter, you're still a son, no matter what. Don't know what you've been taught, don't know what you've been told. All I know is my God. Never let go of you. Oh. I don't know what you've seen, don't know what you've been through. All I know is my God. Never let go of you. Never let go.
Holy Spirit, come. Focused on you and not the chaos and turmoil of this world, Father God. As you guide us, Father God, through this life, and you give us the wisdom and knowledge we need, Father God. We're building your kingdom and not our own. Hallelujah. Praise be to your name, Most High. Hallelujah. Thank you for giving us everything we need, Father God. We have it, Father God, the power of the Holy Spirit, the same power that rose Jesus from the grave. We're here, Father God, and we can use it. Just need to learn how to accept it. Hallelujah. Praise be to your name. We thank you for this worship that we can give to you, Father God. And we thank you for the word that's going to follow. We thank you for opening our hearts to receive it, Father God, and quickening our minds to keep it safe deep within our hearts, Father God. That we can use this word as our ammunition against the troubles that are out there, Father God. It is your word that holds power. Hallelujah. Thank you for forgiveness, mercy, and grace, Father. And we apologize for abusing that mercy and grace. We lift our hearts to you. Hallelujah. In Jesus' precious name, we can come before you, boldly before the throne, and lay our burdens down. Blessed be you. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Amen.
Morning, church.
Good morning.
Another wonderful day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice to be glad.
Amen.
Many of us had battles this morning to get here, but you got here. Many of us didn't want to get out of bed this morning, but we got out of bed and we got here anyway. There is a special blessing. Psalms 149:4 says that he will beautify the meek with salvation. Beautify is to beautify and adorn, or to decorate beautifully. The meek is the humble in Christ, the righteous. So he beautifies the righteous with salvation. So it's good to see all your beautiful faces today. If you macho men that don't want to hear it that way, It's good to see your handsome faces, because I want you to know that you're loved. Amen. So we are celebrating Jesus today. We should be celebrating every day, but we're fashioned together. So we can worship together, so we can celebrate Jesus together. Now we're going to sow into the kingdom. We have a privilege. It is a privilege. God gives us the opportunity to help one another. He always opens up the door. Some people think, how can I help? This is the time to help. This is the time that you can help your brother. It's when you sow into the kingdom, the tithes in your offerings. Just give cheerfully. Give what Holy Spirit tells you. Give cheerfully, because He loves a cheerful giver, and He will bless back a good measure, fresh down, shaking, and running over. More than what you can ever imagine. Not the way that you think, or I think it should be, but He does take care of us, and this ministry does help others. So you will be sowing in to help your brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for another day that you've given us the privilege that we can sow into the kingdom, and that we can bless others as you bless us, and you bless us abundantly. And we give you the praise, we give you the glory, we give you the honor, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, the church confirms by saying,
Amen.
Amen. Give your God.
Megan, stand up. Good. Thank you for the birthday. All must celebrate.
I know, right?
I know.
Church is so good to be in the house of God this morning. Amen.
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 We're glad to be back here this morning. Thank you again. We took a little time off last weekend. I just want to see what God has for us. Amen. I love that song we did, no matter what. No matter what you've done, no matter what you've been through.
Amen.
Aren't you glad we got a no matter what God?
Amen.
All right. Let's hold our Bible and make our confession. Say it like you mean me, like you said. This is the Word of God.
This is the Word of God.
I have what it says I have.
I have what it says I have.
I can be what it says I can be.
I can be what it says I can be.
I can do what it says I can do.
I can do what it says I can do.
My mind's alert.
My mind is alert.
My heart is receptive. I'm a winner.
I'm a winner.
Not a whiner.
I'm
a doer.
I am a doer.
Not just a hearer.
Not just a hearer.
I said I'm a doer.
I'm a doer.
Not just a hearer.
Not just a hearer.
In Jesus' name. All right, y'all sound good this morning. I'm said, we're all part of the body of Christ. So turn to somebody in front of you, behind you, next to you, and say, thank God you brought the rest of my body.
Thank you, God.
Tell somebody God loves you, and so do I.
God loves you, and so do I.
Before we get started, when I'm saying, I just looked back there and I saw it. Whole row filled with a family. I think that's awesome. We've got a lot of people that join us on YouTube, Facebook, but I'd like to see the house full.
Amen.
And y'all start sheep begat sheep. You bring them, I'll feed them.
Okay?
All right. This morning, I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 15. I want to give a shout out to those who join us on Facebook and YouTube. I want to say hi to Gene and Fred. They watch us faithfully from San Antonio every week. And also to Janelle and Dan, Mugambi and the kids in Africa. All those that are watching and join us, we appreciate you being with us today. And if you have a prayer request, please let us know so we can pray for you. Amen?
Amen.
Right. Luke chapter 15. As you turn there, the Bible says, Mary Mark does good like medicine. So I got you some medicine this morning. Remember, these are just humor stories. So please don't be offended. The first one was a Joyce Meyer joke that I heard the other day. A store that sells new husband has opened in Melbourne, where a woman may go to choose a husband. Among the instructions to enter is a description of how the store operates. You may visit the store only once. There are six floors, and the value of the products increase as a shopper ascends the flights. The shopper may choose any item from a particular floor, or may choose to go to the next floor, but you cannot go back down except to exit the building. So a woman goes to the husband's store to find a husband. On the first floor, the sign on the door reads, "For one, these men have jobs." She is intrigued, but continues to the second floor, where the sign reads, "These men have jobs, and they love kids." "That's nice," she thinks, "but I want more." So she continues upward. The third floor sign reads, "Floor three, these men have jobs, love kids, and are extremely good looking." "Wow," she thinks, but feels compelled to keep going. She goes to the fourth floor. The sign reads, "These men have jobs, love kids, are drop dead good looking, and help with the housework." "Oh, mercy me," she says, "I can hardly stand it." So she still wants to go to the fifth floor. And it says, "These men have jobs, love kids, are drop dead gorgeous, help with housework, and have a strong romantic streak." She's so tempted to stay, but she goes to the sixth floor, where the sign reads, "You are a visitor of 31,456,012 to this floor. There are no men on this floor. This floor exists solely as proof that women are impossible to please. Thank you for shopping at the husband." Please note, to avoid gender bias charges, the store's owner opened a new wives' store just across the street. The first floor has wives that love sex. The second floor has wives that love sex and have money and like beer. The third, fourth, fifth, and sixth floors have never been visited.
Yep.
Amen? One more. An old man crashed his car into a very expensive automobile. The owner of the expensive automobile jumps out and confronts the old man and says, "Give me $10,000 cash or I will beat you to a pulp." The old man replied, "Well, wait a minute, buddy. I don't have that much money, but let me call my son. He trains dolphins." The old man dials his son as he's about to speak to the owner of the expensive car, yanked the phone out of his hand, and said, "So you train dolphins? Well, your old man just hit it and damaged my car. You better bring me $10,000 or I'm going to beat the heck out of him and you." The son answers, "Okay, give me 15 minutes and I'll be there." In exactly 15 minutes, the son pulls up in a Jeep. 10 men jump out and beat the heck out of the expensive car owner. Meanwhile, the son walks over to his father and says, "Dad, I train Navy SEALs, not dolphins."
Better watch what you write about.
Luke chapter 15, we're going to begin at verse 11. And he said a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the portion of goods that follow to me." And he divided him his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed the swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, won't you say it?
When he came to himself.
He said, "How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and spare, and I perish from hunger? I will rise and go to my father. I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants." And he arose and came to his father. But when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son." But the father said to his servant, "Bring forth the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And they began to be merry. Church, we're going to talk about the prodigal this morning. Prodigals still exist. These individuals, they rebel, they step away from God's blessings. They indulge in reckless living and ruining their lives. But God runs to meet those who are at the point of total desperation and who are willing to repent and turn to Him.
Amen. Yes.
And this parable in this passage focuses on the character of the nature of God of the Bible. It's usually called the parable of the prodigal son, but I want to call it the parable of the loving father. Jesus used this story to teach us about the character and the nature of his Father. It's no good to believe in God if you believe in the wrong kind of God.
Amen.
As I told you many times when I first got saved, all I knew was that one day I was going to stand behind it before a white-haired man in a throne in heaven. And I didn't know anything else about him until I really got introduced and began to build a relationship with him. But we can know what God is like by how he responds to this rebellious son. We're in Proverbs, Luke chapter 15. Now, I want you to realize, all of us, when we come to God, we are broken people.
Amen.
Yes.
If we weren't broken, we'd fix it ourselves. But we're so broken, we can't fix it ourselves.
Absolutely. Amen.
Now, listen, we're all in different stages of our brokenness. It's as we give God the pieces of our life that he begins to put those pieces together to make us whole. A lot of times, you know, someone comes to the church and they say, man, I'd like to be like pastor, or I'd like to be like the deacon, or I'd like to be like this person. Do you realize I was you one day? I walked through those doors broken one day. And it's taken God, the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, applying it in my life and yielding what God tells me, what the Holy Spirit tells me, to change my life before I start making better decisions, better choices. I change my thinking.
Yes.
Now, one of the hardest things, we're so hard on ourselves. We really are. We're harder on ourselves than God is sometimes.
Yes, amen.
But we change your thinking. You begin to get in line with what God says about you, not what the world says about you, not even what you say about you, or not what the devil says about you. Amen? But as we allow God to put those pieces together, then we become the whole that God wants us to be. And I say we're all in different stages, but we're all learning, we're still growing. When we come here this morning, listen, I didn't come this morning to entertain you. You can't get entertained. You're in the wrong place. I don't sing, I don't dance, and I don't play music. Okay? But I'm going to tell you the truth. And he says the truth is going to make you free.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
Come on. All right. Seven things you'll never hear your dad say. I noticed all your friends have a hostile attitude. I like that. Well, now that you're 13, Princess, I want you to start dating older guys. Well, no son of mine is going to live under this roof without an earring. Why do you want to get a job? I got plenty of money for you to spend. That ain't happening, Dustin. Your mother and I are going away for the weekend. You might want to consider throwing a party. Talk about things you never hear your father say. Here's my credit card, my keys to my car. Go crazy. Last one. Well, it looks like I'm lost. I guess I'll have to stop and ask for directions. Listen, one thing you'll never hear your Heavenly Father say is if you walk away from me, you can never come back.
Amen.
Amen.
Yep.
I'm not sure I've walked away from God. You talking about miserable. Once you've tasted the goodness of God and you try to walk away from that, you're never going to be satisfied.
Amen.
I don't care what you gain in this world, what the world can give you, what you can make, the material things you can gather, you're never going to feel what you feel when you connect with Almighty God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Instead, God is a loving Heavenly Father. He loves you so much that you're free to walk out of fellowship with him, and he won't even stop you. He gave us a free will, church. He's not going to make us do things. He wants to love us into doing things. And he wants, because you love him, that you want to change some things, that you want to do things the way he wants you to do things. Amen?
Amen?
He'll run to meet you more than halfway if you decide to run, return to him. And he says, when you repent, he will treat you as if you never left.
Amen.
Oh, that should be a shout right there.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
Listen, your closest friend, your closest family member, sometimes when you do something with them, they won't forgive you, they won't let it go. But God says when he forgives you, he forgets it, and it's like it never, ever happened.
Exactly. Right? Amen.
You go back to God 5 minutes after you did it, you confessed it to him. He said, I don't know what you're talking about.
Amen.
It's covered under the blood. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, today we're going to look at this parable again, and this time from the perspective of the rebellious son. And I want to read to you from the Message. It says, there was once a man who had two sons. The younger said to his father, Father, I won't write down what's coming to me. So the father divided the property between them. It wasn't long before the younger son packed his bags and left for a distant country. There, undisciplined and disobedient, he wasted everything he had. And after he'd gone through all this money, there was a bad famine all through the country. And he began to hurt. He signed on with the citizen there who assigned him to his field to slop the pigs. I don't know if you've ever been in a pig pen around a pig. Man, them things are nasty. Amen. He was so hungry he would have eaten the corn cobs in the pig slop. That's pretty hungry. But no one would give him any. That brought him to his senses. He said, all these farm hands working for my father's sit down to 3 meals a day, and here I am starving to death. I'm going to go back to my father. I'll say to him, Father, I have sinned against God. I've sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son. Take me on as a hired hand. And he got right up and went home to his father. Now, when he was a long way off, his father saw him. You know what? He was a long way off, but yet his father saw him. You know why? Because he was looking for him. God is constantly looking for us, church, when we walk away from him. When your children walk away from you, doesn't it bring you joy when they come home?
Yes.
Amen? It says, he saw him, and his heart panted. He ran out and embraced him and kissed him. And the son started his speech, Father, I've sinned against God. I've sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son ever again. But the father wasn't listening. He was calling to the servants. Quick, bring a clean set of clothes and dress him. Put the family ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And then get a grain-fed heifer and roast it. We're going to feast. We're going to have a wonderful time. My son is here. He was given up for dead and now he's alive. He was given up for lost and now he's found. And they begin to have a wonderful time. I want you to realize something here. In the first century, a Middle Eastern man never ran. If he were to run, he would have to hitch up his tunic so that he would not trip. If he did this, he would show his bare legs. In that culture, it was humiliating and shameful for a man to show his bare legs. So here's the question. If it was shameful for a man to run that culture, why did the father run when his son returned? What motivated him to shame himself? We got to understand the important first century Jewish custom, church. Kenneth Bailey, an author, explained that if a Jewish son lost his inheritance among Gentiles and then returned home, the community would perform a ceremony called a kazah. They would break a large pot in front of him and yell, you are now cut off from your people. The community would totally reject him. How many times have you repented and God has forgiven you, but people have not?
Amen. Absolutely. Amen.
So why did the father run? He ran in order to get to his son before he entered the village. The father runs and shames himself in an effort to get his son before the community can get to him, so that his son does not experience the shame and the humiliation of their rejection. The village would have followed the running father, and they would have witnessed what took place at the edge of the village between the father and the son. After this emotional reuniting of the prodigal son with his father, it was clear that there would be no kazah ceremony. There would be no rejecting his son, despite what he has done. The son had repented and returned to the father. The father took the full shame that should have fallen upon his son and clearly showed the entire community that his son was welcome back home. Sometimes, even in a church, people do some things and they come back and they repent. And God forgives them. But sometimes even church people won't forgive you.
Amen. Yes.
Amen. Oh me.
Yes.
Oh my. Listen, the application for our own lives is crystal clear. Our Heavenly Father has taken our shame through His Son, Jesus, who willingly endured the cross on our behalf. He took our sins and shame so that we would not have to. As a result, we can be forgiven, we can be restored, and we can be accepted. Listen, God doesn't just want to forgive you, church. He wants to restore you.
Amen.
Amen. God didn't save us just to sit. He saved us to take us someplace.
Right.
Amen. We do not have to fear going home to our father or confessing our sins, no matter what we've done or how many times we've done it. In this parable, only the father could restore the son to full sonship in the family. In our case, we are sinners, And there's nothing that we can do to restore our lost relationship with the holy God of the universe. He calls us and waits a single repentant step in his direction, and he's off running to welcome us home. Not only does God forgive us, but he takes upon himself our shame.
Yes.
He lifts off that weight that we carry on our shoulders for past mistakes.
Yes. Amen.
When God forgave me, I felt like the weight of the world was taken off my shoulders.
Amen.
Because I was carrying a lot of sin, a lot of selfishness, a lot of condemnation, and a lot of guilt. And he willingly wipes the slate clean. May we experience what the prodigal son encountered upon returning to the father. He said, but while he was a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion and ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. I think that's awesome, don't you?
Amen.
Amen. Listen, Charles Dickens said The Prodigal Son is the finest short story ever written. And it's more than just a short story, church. It's a story that touches all of us in different points. Some of you are the parents of prodigals, and you can identify with the pain that this father is feeling. Others are like the son who's wandered away from fellowship with the father. You know, some of us, we go to church and still be drifting away from God.
Absolutely.
You can go through all the rituals and all the formalities and stuff, but where is your heart?
Exactly.
Even the Bible says they worship me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Amen?
Amen.
And still others won't like to admit it, but we're like the older son. The younger son came back. He was lost. He was considered dead. We're like the elder son sometimes. We're religious, but we don't want to forgive.
Amen.
Amen? He wasn't excited that his brother had been lost and been found. It was all about, what about me?
Yep.
What did I fight on that one? I'm not Mr. Rogers. I'm getting in the neighborhood. Amen?
Bring it on.
Well, in this message, I want to examine the steps of a rebellious son, church. I want to learn about the steps away from God and the steps that we can get back to God. If there's anything this country needs today, we need to get back to God.
Amen.
I read an article, a little deal yesterday, and it's talking about if you want to make this country great again, because God made it great in the beginning. If you'll make this country great again, then put God back in all the things.
Amen. Yes.
Put him back
yes.
in the school. Put him back in the church. Put him back in the house.
Yes.
The family. Put him back in our government.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, the younger son didn't just wake up one morning in the pig pen. He ended up there by making a series of bad choices and taking steps that were bad steps. You ever found yourself? Well, you didn't just wake up, oh, how did I get here? It's just the choices that you made that got you.
Exactly.
Amen.
The things that we did. Okay? But remember, he was always a child of his father. But he placed himself in a position where the benefits of the father's resources didn't help him anymore. How many times have we put ourselves in a position or in a place to where God was not able to help us?
Yep.
See, God's not going to go against his word, church. And if we take ourselves out from under his blessing, if we go out there and start doing our own thing, and it doesn't align with his word, God's not going to bless it. He's not going to honor it.
Exactly.
So we can take ourselves out from under the blessings of God. Amen?
Amen.
And once you become a child of God, that relationship is yours. But you can disobey your father and rebel against his will and break fellowship with him. And when you do this, you put yourself in a place where the blessings and the benefits of knowing God are no longer yours. If you can identify with these bad steps, it may help you determine if you need to come back to your father. And some of you said, well, I don't need to hear this. I haven't wandered away. Really? Do you still have the same zeal in your heart that you did when you first got saved? Do you still have the same enthusiasm about reading the Word of God, about spending time with God that you once had? Do you still have the same enthusiasm about coming to church? You know, when 9-1-1 happened, everybody was hollering, God bless America. Before that happened, you weren't expecting what the Bible said, God or Jesus holding anything.
Yep.
But once that happened, everybody's crying out. Why does it have to take tragedy
exactly.
to get us to come
Amen.
To God?
Amen. Yes.
When he's such a loving God. You know the thing about it? He wants to make our lives better.
Yes.
Well, I know some of us, we don't like giving control to God. I'm going to do it my way. But he wants to make your life better. I've said this many times. If you follow God's word, even if there's no heaven, you follow God's word, you're going to be a better father, you're going to be a better husband, you're going to be a better person, you're going to be a better employee, a better employer.
It's true.
Your life is going to, if you apply this in your life. So why wouldn't we want to do something? If your wife loves you, why wouldn't you want to do things for her? Why wouldn't you want to make her happy? Or your husband? Amen?
Amen.
And why don't we want to make a loving God happy by doing the things? He's like any other father. He knows if you go this direction, this is what's going to happen to you.
Amen.
And how many times we told our kids like, well, we did the same thing to our parents.
Yep.
My dad and mom tried to tell me, oh, hey, they're just being old. They don't know nothing. Then I go out there and do it and find out, you know what, they're a lot smarter than I thought they were.
Exactly.
Amen. The first step in walking away from God is a restless attitude. It can be summarized in a statement, no fun. The younger son experienced what all young people feel at one time or another. He got bored with his family and life, and he had an urge to experience the real world. He wasn't having enough fun. And this restless spirit caused the son to demand his inheritance and leave home once he got the money. I don't know about you, but I thought when I was going to get saved, when I come to church, all of a sudden, I wasn't going to have no fun anymore. God was a bunch of dump. If you'll get in Scripture and find out, there are a whole lot more do's than there are don'ts.
Yes,
yes,
right.
Absolutely.
Amen?
That's right.
And we were raised poor, and I got to making money and got my paint contractor. Listen, I went out and bought jet boats. I bought motorcycles. I never had anything. So I was crazy spending. I had everything that money could offer us. But those things didn't make me happy. There was still a hole on the inside.
Yeah.
I was looking for something that money couldn't buy.
Amen.
And church, we're all created, I've told you this before, we're all created to have fellowship with God. There's a hole inside of us we try to fill with everything else, but it will never be filled because that place is for God and God alone.
Yes.
And when you reconnect with Him,
yes,
that hole is no longer there.
Right.
You feel fulfilled. Amen?
Amen. Yes.
Yeah. As far as having fun, I'm telling you what, first time you lay hands on someone that's dying of cancer and you see them, God do a miracle and raise them up, ain't nothing can compare to that.
Amen. That's right.
Amen? Well, Prodigal always thought the grass was greener on the other side of the fence. So he had a desire to go to be on his own. Listen, the grass is greener on the other side of the fence, but you can't afford the water bill.
Okay, thank you.
Also, it might be a leaky septic tank. Amen? Listen, that restless attitude resides in each of us. It goes by different names. In marriage, it's sometimes called the 7-year itch. Although it itches long before and long after the 7-year mark. I've heard husbands and wives speak of feeling trapped. They want out because they're afraid they're going to miss out on some pleasure or experience by staying in their boring old marriage. Listen, if your marriage is boring, it's because you made it that way.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Go back and redo the things you did in the beginning to fall in love with that person. Start treating that person the way you treated in the beginning. Your marriage may change.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
I know I'm meddling.
Nosy.
Listen, I don't think any husband or wife just wakes up one morning and decides they're going to be unfaithful or they're going to leave their mate. It always begins with this uncomfortable feeling of restlessness.
Yeah.
Restlessness is a feeling that they're missing out on the fun. You can go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. And you discover this human hunger is what God is in trouble in the first place. Satan told Eve there's a tree, a fruit, a taste that she was missing out on. And if God was so good, why was he making her miss that taste? And guess what? Satan's lies worked.
Sure,
she believed the devil more than she believed God. And we all have this tendency. Over 200 years ago, a hymn writer, Robert Robinson, spoke for all of us when he wrote, "Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take it, seal it for thy cup, thy courts above." We need to recognize this dangerous feeling of reckless attitude and resist it just like you would any other temptation.
Amen.
Think about the pain and the suffering his younger son would have missed if he had seen his attitude as dangerous and resisted it before he ever left home. If he just recognized that, he would never have to go through the things he went through, church. There would have been a lot less grief, a lot less pain, if we could recognize this restlessness and resist it. It's like a monster in a cage. As long as you keep in the cage, all it can do is roar at you. But once you let it out of the cage, we're headed for a heartache. Amen? Number two, the next downward step is reckless living. The younger son let the monster out of the cage, and he was off in a flash. He was tired of his dad's old rules, so he decided to live by a new philosophy. No rules. The Bible simply says he wasted all of his money on wild living. He bought flashy cars. He bought some new clothes. He headed out to the hot spots to party. He turned the CD player up full blast, saying, "I'm free. I'm free riding." He had a pocket full of money, so now it was party time. Can't you see the bright lights and loud music and the late nights? He was going to have fun, 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 till his daddy took the T-Bird away. Amen. Some of y'all
don't know. That's right. I remember.
He ate, he drank, he laughed. And then in verse 30, the older brother accused him of spending all his money on prostitutes. As long as he was buying the booze, he had plenty of friends. Sound familiar?
Yes.
As long as I had drugs, and as long as I had the booze, and as long as I had the cars, and the boats, and the motor, oh, I had all kinds of friends. When I lost all of that, let all that go, and I got saved, I only had two friends. One of them still sitting back in the back.
Amen.
They were true friends. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Well, finally, he was free. Back home, there had always been rules. His dad had told him some things were wrong and some things that were right. Now he decided if it feels good, it's right. If it doesn't feel good, it's wrong. Church, that's what the world is living on today.
Yep, it is.
He had his own golden rule. He who had the gold makes the rules. He was having the time of his life until he ran out of money. Some of you walk away from your Heavenly Father because you think you can have more fun following your own rules than following God's rules. The Bible says there's pleasure in sin for a season. Oh, it'll make you feel good for a moment, for a little while. I've said this many times, you may get tired of hearing it. But the devil's very subtle. It's kind of like when you're going down the highway and you see this beautiful lady all dressed in an evening gown, and she's advertising Crown Royal. But the devil doesn't show you the next day after she's taken the Crown Royal how she's hugging the toilet and throwing her guts out.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
That means sin's pleasure is only temporary. Sometimes only momentary. Yeah, there's a drunken party, but there's always the hangover. There's a snort of cocaine, but there's always the habit that grabs you. There's the free sex, but there's unwanted pregnancy and disease. Listen, God gave us 10 commandments because he knew we needed order in our lives. We need some kind of order, some kind of boundaries. We don't have rule. That means anything goes. Could you imagine? And that's where our society is headed. Could you imagine what the world would be like? Look what happened to the world in past generations when they had a moral code. And then you look at their life today in this world, and there's no moral code.
Absolutely.
And look where this
world
is going. Amen.
Amen. Yes.
Well, sin's like a lure a fisherman uses to entice a big old bass. If you just throw a bare hook in the water, no bass is going to eat it. But it looks pretty and shiny and resembles something yummy to eat. That old fish is just going to gobble it up. He opens his big mouth expecting a tasty meal. Instead, he gets hooked. What a surprise. Satan always baits his hook with the most attractive, tempting bait. Listen, he knows. He studies you. He's listening to the things you said. He's watching who you hang around with. He knows exactly what to use to tempt you.
Amen.
What tempts you may not tempt me. What tempts me may not tempt you. But the devil knows exactly what to use. Amen?
Yes, amen.
And whereas the big mouth bass finds a hook right away, Satan will play with you for a long time. Sometimes weeks, sometimes months. But one day, he's going to set that hook.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then he's going to start reeling you in. I want to ask us a question tonight. Is that how we're living, church? No rules? See, in today's society, it's all about your rights, my rights. I can't infringe on your rights, you can't infringe on my rights. Everybody has rights. Everybody wants to be different. To be normal is to be weird anymore. Everybody wants to look different, they want to sound different, they want to dress different, they want to talk different. If you're a hard-working, God-loving, family-focused individual, then you're weird anymore. What used to be normal is no longer normal. Amen? The Bible said in the last days, right's going to be wrong, wrong will be right. There is no common sense anymore. Sometimes I don't do as much as I used to, but I still turn on the news sometimes and listen to it. And it just frustrates me. I'm thinking, how darn stupid are you?
Come on, yeah.
Even in the morning when I pray, Lord, I pray for our leaders. And I say, Lord, take the scales off their eyes and
Amen.
Let them see the truth
yes.
and the consequences of their actions.
Yes.
The lady stood up there, I know I'm not supposed to get apologized. The lady stood up there today, she was a spokesman for Biden, and she said that the migrants were not walking across the border. Well, a reporter put a video and it was showing migrants walking across the border. But they're up in Washington, they don't know what's going on down here. Amen? But everybody wants their own rights. They want to play by their own rules. Very famous persons wrote a song. He said, I did it my way.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but when I did it my way, it turned into a mess.
Because
my way is selfish. My way is all about me. Amen?
Amen.
The third step away from God is a ruined life. When his money ran out, all his friends disappeared. He finds himself in the mud, the manure of a pigsty, starving to death. He tried it all, and now he was singing a new song. I can't get no satisfaction.
Okay.
I mean, y'all know, y'all been there.
Yeah.
Amen. I know I have. And so that's the problem with sin. It never truly satisfies. When you get a little, you want a little more, and then you want a little more, and then a little more. Sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and make you pay more than you want to pay.
Absolutely. Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you get one high or one thrill, soon that's not enough, and you want something stronger, you want something more thrilling. Sin never satisfies, and eventually it leads you to suffer. When Jesus added the detail of the son wallowing in the pig pen, we probably just thought gross. But you've got to remember, to the Jews, a pig was ceremonially unclean animal. And I can imagine there was probably a gasp in the crowd when Jesus mentioned the boy was living with pigs and wanted to eat their food. It don't get no worse than that, church. Amen. He had hit rock bottom. I don't know about you, but to be in a pig pen and be willing to share the food with the pigs, that's pretty low. But to a Jewish boy, it was even worse. One of the worst things he could have done. So he hit rock bottom. You know, sometimes God will allow us to hit rock bottom.
Yes, he will.
Sometimes we will not listen to him until we get to that place
Amen.
In our life.
That's right.
And then when we have rock bottom, then we look up. Oh, God, help me.
Yep.
And thank God he's a merciful God.
Amen.
Amen?
Yes.
Good teaching.
The pig pen represents the ugly, putrid, hideous nature of sin. Look what sin has done to some of your family members' lives. Some of my family members have aged so much. You know why? Sin. Listen, if you serve God, do what God tells you, he said he'll restore your youth.
I'm 71 years old, and I feel like a kid sometimes.
Amen.
I mean, I look like it, but sometimes I feel like it. Amen? People say all the time, Roger, you ain't changed in 30 years. I think that is a compliment.
Amen.
Amen. Listen, he set out to be free, but he soon became enslaved to his own sinful appetites. When you run away from God and live a life of sinful disobedience, you may think you're free, but you are a slave to your own sin. Whatever controls you is your master.
Exactly.
Rinald III was an obscure, I want you to listen to this, obscure duke in the 14th century. He reigned the area of what we now call Belgium. Rinald had one terrible vice. He loved to eat. And he was extremely obese. There was a revolt in an area led by Rinald's younger brother. The younger brother captured Rinald and had a prison cell built around him. It had no bars, no windows, no locks on the door. But Rinald was too large to fit through the normal sized door. The younger brother told Rinald when he went on a self-enforced diet and lost enough weight to walk out the door, he would be restored to his wealth and would receive back his crown. But every day the younger brother had sumptuous meals delivered to the prison room, and Rinald continued to eat. History records, Rinald died in the prison cell, a prisoner, not of lock and key, but a prisoner of his own appetite. That's how sin ruins you. You become a slave to it. That which had pleasure at the first soon becomes a prison cell at last. Have you ever been, or maybe you're in something now, and you feel like you're in a prison cell? You feel like you can't get out. You can't get free. You can't let go. You can't get away from it. But yet God says you can.
Absolutely.
But you have to do it His way.
Yep.
Amen?
Yep. Amen.
Listen, there's a law of God that says if you sow sin and disobedience, you're going to reap a bumper crop of suffering. Galatians 6:7 says, don't be misled. No one makes a fool of God. What a person plants, he will harvest.
That's right.
If you don't like what you've been growing, change what you've been planting.
Amen.
It's crazy to plant one thing and believe God's going to bring up something else.
Yeah.
If I plant corn, I'm going to get corn. I'm not going to get peas. Amen?
Amen?
Through the years, I've known hundreds of prodigals. There are teenagers and adults who had a loving relationship with God, but they allowed restlessness and reckless living to enter their lives, and they walked away from God's blessing. They end up in a mess. Some of them are still there. Others have come home. And that's the good news, church. No matter what, God said we can still come home. Aren't you glad you can come home?
Yes.
Amen? And you don't have to wait till you reach the big thing. You can decide to return to the blessing and fellowship with your Heavenly Father anytime. Now I want to talk about the steps to return to God. If you wander away from God, you've allowed sin to take control of your life. It's not hopeless. The Son took three specific steps to return to His Father, and the same three steps will work for us also. And I said, most of the world has turned their back on God.
Sure does.
America used to be a God-fearing nation. There is no fear of God anymore in our nation.
Exactly.
When you say I'm a Christian, people look down on you. When you used to, when you say I was a Christian, they looked up. Amen? But as a whole, our nation has turned their back on God. God is what made this nation different. It was founded on godly principles. And every nation that has wandered away from God has been destroyed. And I sometimes wonder, and I'm not a theologian, I sometimes wonder because in the book of Revelation, when all the armies are coming against Israel, America is not mentioned. America has always been there for Israel to provide and take care of. But for some reason, they're not there. And then one reason they're not there is because God wants them to turn to Him and not to anybody else.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
Listen. The Bible says he came to his senses. That's the first thing that we need to do. Is be honest with ourselves. Look at where we are. Quit making excuses. Quit blaming everybody else.
and be honest with ourselves. It says he came to his senses. This world needs to come to its senses. Like I said, even the Bible said in the last day, right's going to be wrong, wrong's going to be right. You ever found yourself in a place and you think, what am I doing here?
Yes.
How did I even get here? Listen, step by step, day by day. It says he came to his senses. That's the turning point in this parable, church. Before you can return to God, you must realize you're in a mess without him. Everybody else can see your life as a mess. They can even tell you your life is a mess. They can even tell you how to fix your life. But until you decide to do something about it, until you decide to let go, until you decide to forgive, until you decide to quit doing those drugs, until you decide to quit drinking.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying this morning, church? For a moment, let's just climb down in the pig pen with our boy. We're going to climb down. Excuse me, Porky. Loved your movie. Here's our boy covered with the slimy mud, the mess of a pig pen. He's so hungry, he's tempted to eat the pig food. But he can't even eat that because the owner won't allow it. He's being treated worse than the pigs. And finally, when he's about the lowest he can get, a light bulb goes off. You ever had that aha moment? Wow. All of a sudden, it makes sense. Well, he had that light bulb moment. It all clicks. Suddenly, he looks around, and he sees himself for who he really is. Listen, church. It's even in the church house. We're so quick to look at other people and judge other people and criticize other people. But we need to be honest with ourselves. Nowhere in Scripture does he tell you to go around and start examining everybody. He said, examine yourself.
That's right.
Amen? We need to see ourselves for who we really are. We look at ourselves through rose-colored glasses. We make excuses. I'm okay because God understands. But then we look at somebody else's life and look through a magnifying glass. Look at what they're doing. Church, even in Scripture, the religious leaders were putting people down, but yet they were worse than the people they were putting down. And sometimes we're worse than the person we're accusing of stuff.
Amen. Come on, preach it.
Oh, come on, give God some praise.
Amen. You know,
he looks down, he's repulsed by his own filth and dirt. Sin had blinded his eyes. The Bible said the God of this world, Satan, has blinded our eyes. And it takes the truth to penetrate that darkness, to take the scales off our eyes so we can begin to see. Sometimes we're so involved in sin that we don't realize, we're so caught up in it that we don't even think about anything we're doing is wrong. We justify it. It's okay because I'm doing it, but not anybody else. But he says he had to see himself for who he really is. He reached the POTD. That's the point of total desperation. He says, I don't belong here. I'm made for something better than this. Some of y'all need to hear this morning.
Amen.
You don't belong where you are. God has got something better for you.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes.
He said, I'm tired of sin. I'm tired of the sloth. I'm tired of these chains. You ever got sick and tired of being sick and tired?
Yes.
He said, I want to go home. I want to see my daddy. I miss my mama's cooking. I want to go home. Listen, God meets people when they realize they are POTD. And before we reached POTD, he was proud. His attitude was, I'll never go crawling back to my dad and admit I was wrong. I'd sooner die in his pig pen than admit I was wrong. Well, that ought to hit home with some people.
Yeah.
Some of us, we're so prideful, so stubborn, it's hard for us to admit that we missed it. It's hard for us to say, I'm sorry. When you get to the POTD, you stop denying your problem and you get humbled in a hurry. When you get to that point in your life, you don't care who God sends, how God does it, what He uses, who He uses, Lord, I just need help. And the whole of that, we're proud, we're humble, I mean, we're proud, we're arrogant. Well, Lord, if you're going to send somebody to me, you better send a pastor. I don't want a deacon, I want a pastor. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Listen, if you're a drowning person, it don't matter who's on the back throwing you a rope, you're going to grab that rope, amen?
Amen.
Amen. The only way you can approach God is if you live in church. King David was a child of God, but he walked away from God's rules. And he committed adultery, and he committed murder. And he hid it for a long time, but finally he came to his POTD and he repented. He broke down and wept before God and asked him to forgive him his behavior. This proud king was a broken, humble man. And he makes this observation in the midst of his brokenness. In Psalm 51, verse 17, he said, "A broken and contrite heart, O God, will you will not despise." If you'll come before God, no matter what you've done, I don't care how wicked it is, how bad you may feel about it, if you'll humble yourself, come before God, ask Him to forgive you, He will forgive you. Then you have to forgive yourself and not worry about what other people are thinking about you. Amen? What's it going to take for that light bulb to go off in your mind? You may think, oh, that's not that bad for me right now. I'm not really a committed Christian. I just want to go to heaven when I die. I'm a long way from the pig pen. And that may be true. But you don't have to wait until you're at the point of total desperation to return to God. Be smart. Come to your senses today. And then run home to your father. The second step to the road back home. Says after he realized the same shame of his situation, the next thing the prodigal son said was, "I have sinned." He admitted his rebellion was a sin against God. You know, when we sin, we don't think about that. Well, it's don't hurt nobody but me. You're hurting God. You're hurting the heart of God. Because God knows if you continue that sin, it's going to bring death and destruction. Amen? It says, that's what the Bible calls confession. Confession and repentance are two sides of the same coin. Confession always precedes repentance. When you confess your sin, you aren't notifying God what you have done. He already knows. Confession occurs when you agree with God that your behavior is sin. At the same time, you display a measure of remorse and regret over your sin. And that's what we hear in this statement. I have sinned against heaven. Church, when we go before God, we always say, "Well, Lord, I did this, but you've got to see my heart why I did that. I mean, I really did." No, you go before God and say, "Lord, I blew it." Be honest. Be honest with me. I blew it, Lord, and I need some help. Amen? Don't go before God trying to justify or make, just confess. I did it. I'm guilty of it. Now I'm asking you to forgive me. Amen? Amen. Next, he's willing to confess to his father that he's wrong. All sin is against God and must be confessed to God. And some sin is against another person and must be confessed to that person. And the circle of confession should be as large as the circle of the sin, but no larger. You don't have to confess your sin to me unless you've sinned against me. There's some things that you do, you go to God. And there's some things that you did to somebody else. If I did something to Pastor Joy, then I need to go to her. But I don't have to go over to Brother Kenny and tell what I've done to Pastor Joy. You hear what I'm saying? Sometimes you need to go to that person. And listen, when you go to that person, they're not always going to receive what you've got. Sometimes they may get madder at you. They may say nasty things. They may slam the door. But you do what God tells you to do.
Yes.
And that cleanses your heart.
Yes.
And your heart. Amen?
Yes.
Lord,
we're
watching the clock on all three. Okay? He said, do you see the change in our boy? At the beginning of the story, he was saying, "Give me, give me, give me. Give me my inheritance. Give me my freedom." After repenting, he was saying, "Make me. Make me one of your hired servants."
Yes.
That's what real repentance is, church.
Yes.
True repentance is not just admitting you're in the pig pen. It means leaving the pig pen. Repentance involves more than just feeling regret or remorse over your sin. Listen, the world will ask you to forgive them when they get caught. But that doesn't mean they're sorry for what they did.
Come on, amen.
It's being willing to walk away from your sin and walk back toward God. Repentance means changing your mind about your behavior and then being willing to change your behavior.
Yes.
Listen, Jesus doesn't condemn sin, but he does demand repentance. You remember the woman who was caught in the act of adultery who fought for Jesus?
Yeah.
They were ready to stone her to death as the law commanded. Jesus said, let him who is without sin cast the first stone.
Yeah,
I preached a message one day and we had some rock piles down here. And I think that's something to stay in all of our minds. When we start to judge somebody, we start to murmur, we start to complain about somebody, we need to run. You don't have no sin in your life and you can cast a stone. If you got sin in your life, you got no business throwing a stone at nobody.
Amen.
In a matter of minutes, they all dropped their rocks. And Jesus was up alone with the woman. He forgave her and sent her on the way, her way. But he said, go and sin no more. He was quick to forgive, but it requires willingness on our part to repent. Now, are we willing to admit to God that our life is a mess? Are we willing to walk away from our sin? And if we are, then we're ready for the final step back to God. Number three. Return. And says he came to his senses, admitted his sins. He was ready for the final step. In verse 18, he says, I will go back. Two of the most powerful words in the human language are, I will. It was by an act of will that he decided to demand his inheritance and run away from home. It was an act of his will he decided to go get out of that pigsty and head back home. He didn't say, I'm going to send a letter to my dad to come get me. No, he knew that it was he and he alone that had to walk out of that mess and go back home. Can't you picture him? He was prancing and strutting when he left home. But now he's weak, he's thin, he's dirty, and he's hungry. He smells like a pig. The trip home was a lot longer than the trip away from home. But he had one thought in his mind. His home. Church, it said when he came, his dad came running down the road. Think about that. God loves us so much. He's not just sitting there waiting for you to get there. No, he's going to meet you. God will meet you today right where you are. He'll forgive you. He'll love you. He'll forget. Like it never happened. And someone said, well, I haven't strayed away from God. Maybe you're not like the prodigal son. Maybe you haven't run totally away. But in your heart, you're not where you used to be. You don't have the desire or the zeal or the hunger that you once had. Some of us, we've been in a situation when we needed God to move. Man, we got serious. We come to church. We read our Bible. We pray. We watch what we say. And then when the storm passes, we'll go back to being just talk to the Lord. You remember when he was talking to the churches in Revelation, he said, you need to go back and do your first works over. You've left your first love. See, some of us serving, it's all about serving God as long as God is healing, delivering, blessing, protecting. No, you serve God because you love him.
Amen.
You fell in love with him. And you found a love you've never known before. And that's why you serve him. That's why you want to change. That's why you do the things you do.
Amen.
If you do things out of fear, as soon as the fear is gone, you're going to go back to being who you were. Or who I was. Amen.
Amen.
It says he come running down the road, he opened his arms wide, and he hugged him and he kissed him. He smelled like a pig. Someone said, well, whoa, wait a minute, son. You go get a bath and I'll hug you and I'll love you. No. Our God takes it with our sins, our filthiness, our smell. It don't matter. He still loves you just as
Amen.
You are.
Yes, yes.
No matter how far we've wandered. Amen?
Amen. He said he put a robe on his back, a ring on his finger, shoes on his feet. Everybody was happy. Everybody was ready to celebrate. And then he says he killed the fatty calf. The fatty calf was the only one who wasn't happy with the story. And so they began to celebrate. Listen, though we reject God, God never rejects us. He lovingly awaits our coming to him with his arms wide open, longing to receive and restore us without hesitation. He said he gave him a robe. That robe was forgiveness, covering our sin and our shame. A ring restored his identity and belonging to his family. Then he said he put sandals on his feet, a renewed purpose and meaning for life. He gave him hope. A boy asked his father, "Dad, what's the size of God?" Then the father looked up at the sky and he saw a plane and asked his son, "What is the size of that plane?" The boy replied, "It's very small. I can hardly see it." Then the father took him to the airport, and as they approached the plane, he asked, "Now, my son, how big is this plane?" The boy replied, "Wow, Dad, it's huge." Then the father told him, "God's size depends on how close or how far you are from him. The closer you are to him, the greater and greater he will be in your life."
Amen.
Amen. Could he come running, hug you, kiss you? Church, that's how God will respond to us today. He's inviting you to return to him. And that's really the entire theme of the whole Bible. God is saying to lost and sinful humanity, "I love you and I want you to return to home." In Joel 2:13, he says, "Rend your heart, not your garment. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate." We always want to do things. We always want to do physical things. God says, it's not all about, it's not about the sacrifice. It's not about, he said, it's all about your heart. Where's your heart? He says, out of the heart, abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. You find out what's really important to people by listening to what they say.
Amen.
Amen. Church, if that's what you need today, if you need to come home to God, in the Wizard of Oz, Dorothy was right about one thing. There's no place like home. You may be a child of God who's wandered for years. It's time to return home. You may need to find a church home. We are the body of Christ, church. We open our arms. Listen, anybody wants to come to this church, I don't care where you came from, what you went through, what you're going through, we're not going to turn you away.
Amen.
Jesus never turned anybody.
No.
Some churches, I went to a church one time because I had long hair and a beard. I felt like a porcupine in a bloom factory. I didn't fit. Listen, when you come here, I don't care what you look like, how you are, what you've done, what your background is. We're going to love you.
Amen.
He says it's goodness of God that brings us to repentance. If we love one another, then you want to do things for one another. Amen. You tired of wandering? Tired of being weary? Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Are you ready to come home today? Are you ready to come home today? Last scripture, 2 Chronicles 7:14. "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land." We think about the land, we think about the country, we think about the community. This is your land too. God will heal your life.
Yes.
He'll heal your family. He'll put you all back together. We're not like Humpty Dumpty. God can put us all back together.
Amen.
And put us back together the right way, his way. I want to close by doing this. I want to reach out to those that are joining us before. And we're going to play a song. And I want you to listen to the words of the song in just a moment. If you're watching this by YouTube or Facebook, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Bible says if you'll ask him to forgive you for your sins, believe he died for your sins, you believe he rose again, you believe in your heart, you confess it with your mouth, you shall be saved. Just ask him to come in. Lord, forgive me of my sin. Come in and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you died for my sin. I believe that you rose again. And I receive the gift of eternal life. He did all the work, church. All we got to do is act of our will, choose to receive him and make him Lord of our lives. Guys, go ahead and put that song on. If you really listen to this word, the altars are open if you need to come to the altar. And then we'll have prayer after this, okay? Did y'all receive this one?
Amen. Amen. Yeah.